This is a great example of a gap disturbance. About 2 years ago, a cluster of trees here were blown over by the wind. And you can see, probably from your perspective, you can see a little bit of it. I'll shoot some shots to show you the rest. There's a number of trees back here that have all fallen in the same direction. It might be even as many as a dozen trees. So it's small in area, but quite a few trees. And you'll notice they're all in the same direction. So that's one thing that gives you a clue that it was wind that blew down these trees. Aside from the fact that the trees are all lying in the same direction, another hint that we have is looking at this tip up here. So I can see, I'll show you a closer view as well, but I can see all of the fine roots of this tree. I'm seeing roots here that are maybe just a millimeter in diameter. If root rot, for example, was something that weakened the tree and wind was just the final straw that knocked it over, you're only going to see big, coarse roots that are maybe 5, 10, 20 centimeters in diameter. You're not going to see these fine roots. Those would stay in the soil. The other thing to notice is that the soil here, the soil that came up with the tree, is incredibly narrow. Let me take a look from the side here. It's really, oh man, it's probably no more than 20 or 25 centimeters. So all of the trees in this area were exposed to the same wind, but only this cluster blew down. And the reason for that, if you looked, were to see on the trail here, there's a boardwalk for the trail here because this is a spot that is seasonally wet. Also, if you look around here, in contrast to some of the areas we were earlier that were almost all Douglas fir, here it's maybe, there's a little bit of Douglas fir, but right in this particular spot, it's nearly all Western red cedar. Western red cedar is a much better competitor in wetter, richer areas. So this is a wet soil here, and trees don't like to have their roots submerged. Most trees don't. So if there's a high water table in the soil, trees will tend to have very shallow roots. They won't put their roots down very far because there's no advantage to them being down there. And so for that reason, if you have an area that's very wet, you've got a lot of trees that are relatively shallow rooted, then when a big wind comes across, they're much more susceptible to wind throw. They're much more susceptible to being blown down. One other interesting thing here, I notice on these fallen logs, in areas where the bark has sloughed off, I can see galleries of insects in here, and I can see it on some of the bark as well. I'll have to ask one of my entomologist colleagues what insect this is, but I suspect this is a case where this was a insect that feeds on dead trees, so that after these trees fell, they were dead, the insects came in and consumed the cambium and laid their eggs there. So I recognized that these were insect galleries, and sometimes being a good scientist is knowing who to ask. So I asked Professor Alan Carroll, a forest entomologist in the department, if he could give me an idea of what species these insects might have been. So for this one, he said that these galleries are diagnostic of Phloocinus species, and he said probably Phloocinus punctatus, the western cedar bark beetle. So these are bark beetles that attack weakened cedars and junipers, and you can see here on the left side of this gallery, this is where the female initiated the gallery and mated with the male, and then the female and male together excavated this gallery, and the female laid eggs in little notches evenly spaced along the gallery wall. Then those eggs hatch, and the larvae feed within the phloem and mining perpendicular to the main gallery. And what's kind of cool is if you follow these lines, here, let's follow one of these, you'll notice that it gets wider as it goes away, and that's because the larvae was growing as it progressed further away. And then when they mature, you see these kind of disappear and they actually emerge from the bark and fly away and move on to mate and lay eggs themselves. So Alan's pointing out that from this gallery, the gallery in the middle had approximately 35 larvae successfully emerge and develop. This plant has been recently implicated, or sorry, this species has been recently implicated in extensive western red cedar mortality that we've been seeing on the west coast. Part of it is that there's been several years of droughts, and when red cedars, or when any tree experiences sufficient drought, it can make them more susceptible to attacks. So this insect doesn't normally attack healthy trees, it normally attacks weakened or dying or recently killed trees. So since these trees blew over, they still had healthy phloem, and they might have still even had some roots in the ground after they blew over, but they were clearly in a weakened state where they wouldn't be able to defend against this attack.
Alan said that the galleries are well developed and suggest that the attack initiated in the spring. And if I remember correctly, these trees blew down in a storm in December. So I think they still would have been in very weakened condition, but the phloem would have been in good condition in that spring. So that allowed the larvae of these bark beetles to be able to fully mature and emerge and then disperse to new trees, completing their life cycle. This next one, and I didn't have my hand in the first photo, I wish I had for some scale. Those things were relatively small. Those bark beetles are about the size of a grain of rice. So here you can see my hand in this one for bigger scale. So here is one of those galleries from the bark beetles. But this photo, I was more interested in these very large, irregular galleries. So Dr. Carroll said that the larger galleries were made by a species of wood borer. And based on the location and that this is a western red cedar, it's probably Trachycale blondelli, or the western cedar borer. This is a beetle from the family Buprestidae, and like most Buprestid beetles, this species lay their egg individually on trees that have been damaged or otherwise defensively compromised. So again, not a healthy tree, but a tree that isn't going to be able to resist the attack. So just like we have in this case with these trees that have been blown down. And then the larvae mine through the phloem tissue as they grow, but eventually they turn inward and bore through the sapwood. And if you follow this tunnel here, you can actually see at the end, there's a little hole there and that tunnel kind of ends. So that isn't where that wood borer emerged from the bark. It's where it actually went further into the tree. And this species of wood borer is unique in that the larvae pass all the way through the sapwood and keep going into the heartwood. So those bark beetles were just staying right under the bark, but this wood borer is going well into the tree. Loggers often refer to this beetle as the powder worm due to those tunnels in the heartwood that are full of boring dust. And the tunneling in the heartwood in particular makes this beetle particularly dangerous to loggers, because if there are trees that have been attacked but are still standing, the tops of those trees may be weakened from this boring and may potentially, while the tree is being cut down, the tops of the trees may fall, injuring or killing the fallers on the ground, the people who are cutting down the tree. And Alan noted that given that this species takes a couple of years to develop, he suspects that the larvae are probably still in these logs deep in the heartwood.